So it is probably no coincidence that the movement finally achieved an important victory only at the European Court of Human Rights, which confirmed all previous claims and demands of the arrest, and which somehow pushed the Slovene government out of this intolerable position of political manipulation and legal inaction. I would say I've learned three important lessons from the movement of the arrays. And the first is that it is possible to struggle in all conditions, even in the most unbearable conditions. And no, the individual stories of the arrays, their survival strategies, they are horrifying, but simultaneously so inspiring. You must trust in human ingenuity and resilience in any case. You can struggle. So the second lesson is the awareness that in the context of an absolute non-existent dialogue with the power, from the side of the power, of course, the method of conflict is the most productive. You know, inside of the movement of the arrays, there was a constant struggle with a tendency that was somehow against all political action and was trying to solve this problem in an exclusively legal manner. But at the end, no legal solutions would be applied if there was not a continuous social conflict that pushed for political solutions. And the third lesson is connected to the concept of transition. You know, one day you're a respectable citizen, or more or less, and the next day you are erased. You know, you are you cease to exist from one day to the other. So there is no certainty. All statuses are precarious. And in every group of statuses, you can find all other groups of statuses. So every struggle, therefore, carries this transitional and mutualist dimension. An important qualitative leap in the activism in Slovenia was the occupation of a former bicycle factory in Ljubljana. This was in 2006. As you all know, in post-socialist countries, all previously social property was nationalized in order to be later privatized. So when we became active in the early 2000s, we already felt what we later experienced in practice, the importance of a physical space. The possibility to come together, to collaborate, is important in every form of collective endeavor, especially in political endeavor. But access to space was getting more and more restricted, more and more exclusive. So as a new political generation, we felt the need to conquer a new material and symbolic space, which could be a reflection and also a critique of these processes of privatization, of dispossession of new enclosures. So the factory was owned by municipality of Ljubljana, and for various speculative reasons, it was left empty for 15 years. So we decided to open it, to squat it, literally, for various independent social, cultural, political production. But at the same time, we built rock in accordance with our political activities, which were evolving around migration and Eurasia. At that time, we were part of the so-called network for permanent visits, which was a loose coordination of activists and researchers, or activist researchers, that entered the detention camp in Postojna and tried to monitor it in a certain way, because these institutions are very close, and this one is Postojna, in Postojna was particularly close. So this network simultaneously organized a network of guarantees which actually enabled to bring people out of the detention center. And as Rok slowly developed, we thought, okay, this space needs to accommodate also these kind of needs. We need space for people that are self-managing the borders, as we said. And that was the period when we decided to build a social center inside of Rok. Soon afterwards, we started to work with a group of formal asylum seekers in Ljubljana, and managed to write a document together with them about the situation of asylum in Slovenia. And this document involved a detailed analysis of the conditions inside of the home, which were basically carceral, as the same as the detention center, and they still are. The main complaints involved around the verification procedures, around interviews and so on. But the main political demand of this document was directed against the Slovenian asylum policy, or against the fact that Slovenia has one of the lowest approval percentages in whole the European Union, so that no one actually gets asylum. But I think that the most important demand of this movement was the demand to abolish all detention centers, camps in Slovenia and Europe. You know, you're an asylum seeker, you live in asylum home for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, of course, then your application is denied, then you are transferred to detention center, you spend another 6 or 12 months there, and then you are either deported or you are left out in the territory without any status and without any possibilities of regularization because of the Dublin Convention. So our demand to abolish these institutions was based on the premise that they have no other function except of deterrence and the production of mass illegality in Europe. So that these institutions actually produce illegality in Europe. So there were some impacts of this campaign. I mean, in the next 2 years, there were more asylums were given than 20 years before altogether. But of course, there were no major systemic changes. And we must not forget that the question of asylum is already a story of the wider European border management, as is the question of the working migration, which became the central focus of our struggle in the I'm working hard here. The first investigation of the working migration ran somehow parallel to this asylum campaign, and it started with workers' dormitories in Ljubljana. The reaction of the migrant workers was really surprising, because it seemed they were eager to share their views on their living and working conditions, which they found dramatic, and we did also. So through a method that we called a militant investigation, which involved common meetings, assemblies, interviews, conversations, also social events, for example, karaoke. It's a great research tool, by the way. We tried to discover the deeper systemic roots of these conditions. And in contrast to the erased or the asylum seekers, we found that illegality was not one of them. You know, the majority of third country migrant workers living in Slovenia come from countries of former Yugoslavia, most of them from Bosnia. At the peak of working with migration recruitment in 2007, they consisted 10% of the active working population, which is really a lot. But they, majority, a vast majority of them work legally and stay legally. But they could be exploited as illegal. So due to a complex system of work permits and bilateral agreements, the workers were completely dependent on their employers, and so they had to endure all these violations imposed on them. So in order to keep the employment and the right to stay in the country, which is linked to the former, they would bear all those breaches, working rights breaches and so on. As in the vast majority of other European countries, the legal framework of the working migration produces populations that can be in practice treated as if illegal. And the most important conclusion I would get from this campaign is that it really challenged the concept of the fortress that seemed to be accurate in the case of asylum. The working migration from the third countries is not only tolerated, but it is encouraged, promoted, but in a very hierarchical and exclusive manner that mainly benefits the European economic power. So the aim of European border management is not to stop migration, but to promote a certain kind of mobility and to arrest another one. To sum up, we could say that the campaigns of the political entity now known as the social center were always linked to migration or migration issues, citizenship issues, but they have always addressed broader questions of the global division of wealth and power. And the occupation of Rogue was one of the attempts to critique the processes of gentrification, privatization, the disappearance of public space, the increased precarity, visibility of ever larger parts of society. So Social Center is now like a hybrid of all previous campaigns, comprised of people, different nationalities, social, cultural backgrounds, and so on. It is a space of encounters, where different realities meet and at the same time change through common practices, through common struggles. And I would say the vital importance of physical spaces like this is by sharing a common infrastructure, it is a kind of an income. And this is the material dimension. But there is also a political and social dimension. While activists built this space, and while they built a social network that sustains it, they also built another kind of welfare, I would say a common welfare, which is very, very important since most of the activists are, as most of the population is excluded from the traditional welfare or the social state. And I will stop here because.
Thank you, Barbara, for this experience, activist experience from the citizens' movement, and this solidarity with this story about solidarity with erased, with migrant workers, with asylum seekers, which was, I guess, also fed into the protests that happened later in Maribor and all Slovenia, and also the Occupy movement in 2010, and then all the other protests in Maribor and all Slovenia against the political and economic elites, because it shows this kind of a line in history and what was the background also to this protest.